Good afternoon, everyone. I welcome you all to our series of webinars and my deepest gratitude to you for attending this unique series. I'm Dr. Ankur Lad, Scientific Manager, Horiba, and will be moderator for today. So let me borrow a few minutes of your precious time. This might interest hematologists and pathologists alike. You might have noticed logo in the teaser, HABH, and I'm sure most of you are familiar with it. But for those who are not, allow me to give you a brief. HABH, or Hematology Analyzer-Based Exchanges, is a distinctive digital platform to enhance scientific knowledge in hematology. This was started a few years back and was successful in connecting and enrolling high number of hematologists and healthcare professionals. This has evolved with time and has become more secure and easy to use. Here, healthcare professionals can learn about hematology, its parameters, their clinical utilities, and recent advancements. This also provides unique opportunity to publish technical write-ups, scientific literature, useful videos, and also helps hematology researchers and students to conduct research studies on the subject. In addition, one can get opportunity to interact with other hematologists and can seek out expert opinion if required. What more, you also get rewarded for your scientific work. I mean, you name it and we will do it for you. Amongst the new features, the site contains integrated Android and iOS app links to foster improved accessibility to users. And we are constantly appraising our content with supportive information, articles, blogs, newsletters, webinars, recent updates, and much more. To learn more, join our website www.habx.in and get introduced to the endless possibilities in hematology. Now let's come back to the webinar. Here, everyone is interested in knowing about cells and parameters. So we have started a unique series, CBC, not complete blood count, but count beyond cells. This series will emphasize particularly on parameters or counts which get deranged during monsoon season. I mean, like diseases like dengue, malaria, these things. And whenever you think of the webinar, what is the first thing that comes in your mind? Oh, another boring hour, right? But this one is going to be a twist in the tale. Topic conveys that, and this is going to be a little humorous, and of course, like always, an edifying one. Platelets has always been an important parameter, but monsoon makes it more imperative, as this season is followed by diseases in which platelet count not only becomes a diagnostic factor, but also a prognostic factor. And of course, we are all aware about technicalities and contradictions in platelet counting. And new age analyzers are leading the way. And obviously, innovations like optical platelet counting are giving hematology a whole new dimension. Today, in many centers, manual counting has become obsolete. You'll be surprised to know now many centers don't use manual counting anymore. A medical fraternity globally recognizes the role of platelet transfusion in management of hospitalized dengue patients. But the exact indication and situation in which these are to be transfused may vary. So here comes the role of parameters like PLCC, PLCR, which can guide us for transfusion. Of course, we'll be discussing, Handu sir will be discussing these things. This is such a topic that I can continue forever, but let's call upon the expert of the subjects, know all about platelets, counting techniques, innovations, advancements, role in monsoon diseases, etc., etc., etc. Oh, one more thing. We are also going to have an exciting question and answer session at the end of the webinar. Meanwhile, you can type your queries in the chat box. So let me have the honor to call upon Dr. Anil Handu, the master himself. He does not need any introduction, but for the new attendees out here, he is senior consultant, hematologist, and senior director, hospital lab services, academic affairs, research, and counting education at prestigious Max Healthcare Institute and also at Dr. B.L. Kapoor Memorial Hospital, New Delhi. He has done MD pathology and he has also done fellowship in hematology medicine from UK and fellowship and flow cytometry from Australia. and he has many papers and publications to his name. Over to you, sir.
Thank you very much, Ankur. So, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. At the outset, I would like to thank Horiba for giving me this opportunity to share my thoughts about the platelet counts. And what better moment can it be than this monsoon season, you know, where we are so engrappled with the requirements of getting platelet counts done right, left, and center. Now, here is the monsoon, and I would all of us want to have a beautiful picture of monsoon around us, nice, beautiful rains, beautiful weather, you know, probably sit at home and have a cup of chai with nice pakoras and lead a beautiful life at home. But at the same time, we also know that there are certain things like monsoon wedding, watch movies, and enjoy life. However, monsoon also gets with itself a lot of problems, you know, which includes waterlogging and people suffering because of waterlogging. And to add to it, the health woes which come in due to the presence of the mosquito-borne diseases and other diseases which come along with the monsoons in this weather. And therefore, when you have such a weather, you are obviously bound to get certain diseases which can give rise to problems. And that's where a role of platelet comes in, because the moment this disease comes in, you get stuck. And I will just take you through the realms of history, which happened many, many years back in 2013. You know, everyone likes to be in the news, but nobody likes to be in the news for wrong reasons. And unfortunately, I happen to be one of those people who was projected across as somebody, you know, who was doing some wrong things with respect to platelet count. And our hospital was also projected like that. Many other hospitals and laboratories across Delhi, NCR, and maybe even in the other states were projected in a very negative manner, all because of only one single aspect, and that's nothing but the platelet count. So where does this automated platelet count come about, and why do we actually worry about it so much, is what we want to talk about it, and how does it work. Now, I'm showing you three very interesting personalities in front of you here, and I would have really loved to have an answer to these questions, but the question is, like, if you look at these three personalities and then you look at the platelets, I don't know what should be common between the three of them, the four of them, in fact. So if you look at the platelets here and you look at the other three personalities, which included, Sanjay Dutt and Rakhi Sawant, and of course, the gentleman here, Raga. So if you look at all of them together and then you compare it to the platelets, the general connotation which anyone should take out of it is pretty simple. They're forever controversial. Something or the other keeps happening in their lives, and they keep us entertained throughout. And that's what happens even with the platelets. And when you look at the platelets also keep giving you trouble right, left, and center. So now I delve into the talk further, and I have actually divided my talk into all these sub-aspects, where I'm going to talk a little bit about historical aspects, counting methods of platelets, the impedance platelet counting, why and where it has a problem, the optical or the fluorescent counting, which a lot of people talk about, immunological platelet counting, flow cytometry-based platelet counts, of course, slide-based platelet counts, which is something which a lot of us keep doing even today, and in vivo platelet count, which is something on the anvil, best methodology, of course, a little bit about quality assurance, if time permits, a little bit of about a few cases. Now, the entire responsibility of getting us to the platelet is because this gentleman, the scientist, the Italian pathologist, Fusario, actually was the first person to identify platelets as distinct corpuscles, and he was the one who actually gave us very distinctive role about platelets and their functioning in coagulation and thrombosis. And at that point of time, the historical techniques for platelet counting, you know, basically fall into four groups, out of which one is the direct methods by hemocytometry, where you're putting it on a Newburst chamber and putting on a microscope, and indirect methods wherein red cells were counted directly in proportion to the platelets on a stained blood film, which in fact is done by a lot of us even today, despite having the state-of-the-art hematology analyzers with us. Of course, the other platelet counting methods which were there at that point of time in vogue were the semi-automated methods, on which you needed a platelet-rich plasma to actually come on to the actual counting. And of course, the fully automated methods which we are all using nowadays. So let's look at history a little bit more in detail. The first automated platelet counting became available as reverse dark-free microscopy many, many, many years back. And of course, the technology available was that on Technicon hematology and automated counting, cell counting analyzer. Eventually, as the hydrodynamically focused systems came up into the picture and the whole blood picture of impedance counting started becoming more prevalent, that's the time when the platelet count started becoming more reliable. And of course, we all know about counting two times or three times, what's called as triplicate counting and stuff like that, and giving what is called a fitting curve. Eventually, we also know that, you know, the lasers came into the picture and all the automated hematology analyzers, and we went on to do what is called optical flow cytometry based cell counting. And in that, we were using two angle light scatter devices in which low angle scatter and high angle scatter was looked at, which was looking at the refractive index and the cell size. And based on that, the platelets and the red cells could also be counted. Now, what's the reference method for counting the platelets? The reference counted as per the International Council for Standardization in Hematology was given in 1988, wherein they had very clearly mentioned that the platelet counting should be based on whole blood. And the important point was that they didn't want platelet-rich plasma to be used because it will give you erroneous counting. And the method of choice was the manual phase contrast chamber counting, which a lot of people do even today in our country. Now, what is the current reference method? The current reference method for counting of platelets worldwide is the 2001 flow cytometric based platelet counting, and wherein it is using the RBC to the platelet ratio and gives us the counts. And it's also mentioned very clearly that CD41 and 61, which identify specific antigens on the platelets, will enable identification of platelets by flow cytometry, and that gives you what is called the flow cytometry based platelet counting. And this is considered as the standard methodology of platelet counting today. So this is the picture which you get from a typical flow cytometer. You are actually getting the platelet counts across on the RBCs versus the platelets. So this is the fluorescence part of it, and of course you get the RBCs which are on the forward scatter, which have a larger size compared to what you get on the platelets. Now, a lot of automated analyzers have these technologies incorporated into them, and the Horeba instruments are no different. There also we have the availability of the optical as well as the impedance methodologies. And the important aspects with respect to automated counting needs to be emphasized here. Now, why am I showing this picture is only to emphasize on the simple fact that whenever a sample is actually pushed into a hematology analyzer, what is obvious is that you have it dividing it into two components. The first component, which goes into the RBC and the platelet channel, and the second one, which goes to the WBC channel. And when we look at the RBC platelet channel, it is this particular channel which contains wherein both the RBCs as well as the platelets are counted. Now, the moment we are going to count RBCs and platelets together, and especially on the impedance, there obviously is going to be interference between the two. And that's why it becomes important for us to know that the platelets will interfere within the RBCs and the RBCs will interfere into the platelets. But by sheer numbers, the RBCs happen to be far more in number, and therefore their effect on platelets is going to be far more compared to what the platelets will cause on the RBC numbers. Now, impedance-based platelet counting is what is in vogue in majority of the hematology analyzers across the globe, and the credit for this goes to the Coulter brothers, the Joseph and the Wallace Coulter, who in fact came out with what is called the Coulter principle. And in this principle, the cells pass through and between the two electrodes, the positive and the negative, and depending upon the cell size variability, the oscillations come about, and these oscillations give you a graphic detail. So based on that graphic detail, you're able to get the information about the size of the cell, which you can see in this picture. The larger cell will give you a larger impulse, and a smaller cell gives you a smaller impulse. And again, when you apply the thresholds to separate, you know, the smaller cells from the larger cells, you're able to differentiate between platelets and the red blood cells very easily. Now, the first Coulter platelet counter was what was used previously for impedance-based counting, used the platelet-rich plasma. However, we all know that currently we don't do that. We actually use what is called the whole blood directly into the machine. And there is also a concept of hydrodynamic focusing, which ensures that the issues which we have, because of the nature of the cells, that, you know, the cells come back into the same area for calculation and analysis, is taken care of. So hydrodynamic focusing eventually helps us to ensure that the cells fall in a very single straight line, and you are able to count them individually and give an appropriate counting. And these eventually, the pulses which are coming into from these cells which are passing through the two electrodes, you are then able to convert them into sizes as per their thresholds. And then those histograms, as per the frequency in each channels, you have the numbers. And you also have kept in some of the analyzers, there is something called moving threshold, so that there is any, the discrepancy between two counts can be taken care of by looking at the moving threshold. So these are various pulses which come
excuse
in.
Excuse me, sir. Yes. Sorry to interrupt. Sir, your voice is slightly low. So please increase the,
All right, no problem. So that's what we do, and that's how the pulses are taken. Eventually, when you look at the pulses, all these pulses together are then forming what is called a histogram, as you can see in this picture. Some of the analyzers, like Beckman-Coulter instruments, have the mechanism of counting these cells multiple number of times, and at least the triplicate counts are taken, and when they have an averaging out and they're able to put a fitting curve, you're able to get hold of what is called the accurate platelet counts. So there's something called triplicate counting, which I told you previously. You count them repeatedly just to make sure that there is any interfering substances, they are taken care of. And eventually, once you put what is called the smoothened fitted curve, whatever counts come out of these smoothened fitted curves as the count, which is absolutely reliable. Now, these are important points. Just remember that whenever you are putting platelets through the curves, you are actually ensuring that the curves are kind of getting taken care of. Now, there is also an important aspect to remember that when you look at the patterns of these curves, you are able to differentiate between various problems which the patients might be having. For instance, in this particular case on the top left, you are able to see a normal patient pattern. Compared to that, when you have an interference of the RBCs, because they will be falling on the right side of the platelet count, again, presence of giant platelets, presence of low counts or low interfering substances, very tiny fragments. And of course, fit failed patterns, wherein you know that the counts from the analyzer are not reliable and therefore need to be reviewed and redone as per the mechanisms available within your laboratory. So these are the various issues which people need to be taking care of. Peak at the left end of the spike, you have cytoplasmic fragments. Obviously, one will need to review a smear. And if you have a spike to the right end of the histogram, in a platelet fit curve, you know that you're looking at something which is fragmented up from the red blood cells. And of course, when you have a bimodal peak, you can have both the cytoplasmic fragments, the smaller and the larger ones, which can give rise to problems in understanding and taking care of these cases. Now, this is what happens with the platelet and the RBC interference. As I told you previously, the platelets and the RBCs, since they're counted in the same channel, and you have the platelet RBC channel, that's what it's called. So there will be overlap between the RBC and the platelets whenever there are smaller RBCs or larger platelets. And that's when the counts start becoming relatively unreliable. Now, that is where the importance of the new analyzers comes into the picture. And if you look at it, there has been evolution from the impedance, inclusion of optics, and eventually combination of impedance and optics in some of the analyzers, which has started giving you methodologies to evaluate platelets on a dual platform methodology and give you what comes to be the best possible platelet count. So if you look at the optical and the fluorescent automated platelet counting, the important point is that you need to have a fluorescence-based, optical-based analyzer in which you will have a laser stream, which will be able to give you the laser onto the cells. And eventually, if you are putting up the fluorescent dyes along with it, they are able to identify the cells and give you a specific fluorescence depending upon the content of the RNA and the other material within them. And that's how you are able to actually differentiate between various cell types. So you have a cell size. The cell size gives you variability in terms of the number of cells. For instance, platelets will be the small cells. And if you look at the red blood cells, they'll be much larger in content. And as you look at the fluorescence part of it, the fluorescence will also be different from each other, and therefore you'll be able to differentiate. So this is the principle of optical technology, which I was telling you previously also, wherein I was already mentioning that light comes at different scatters. The forward scatter gives you the size, and the side scatter gives you the complexity, and of course, the complexity of the cell as well, and you're able to identify it. And the moment you add, a fluorescent dye to it, and some of the analyzers, you're able to get them differentially on a scatter plot and identify them separately, just as the way you're finding this in this particular scatter plot. You're able to identify and differentiate between debris, the platelets, and the large platelets, similarly in many other analyzers as well. If we look at the analyzers from Horeba, they have a reticulocyte channel on their analyzer called H2500, wherein the cytometry, the platelets from the RBC platelet channel of impedance are made to go through the cytometry-based channel, and eventually they are able to give us differential counts of the platelets based on optics. And as you can see in this particular channel also, you are able to very clearly distinguish between the platelets as well as the red blood cells, the red ones being the red blood cells and the yellow ones being the platelets. And again, depending upon how complex the information will come out from there, you may also be able to identify some small other fragments like cell fragments, etc. from this channel. Similarly, from other analyzers wherein the fluorescent platelet counting is done, you are able to differentiate between the microcytic hypochromic red cells and the fragmented red cells from the platelets, as you can see here. Some of the analyzers called it fluorescent platelets, the others call it optical platelets, and these are the platelets which are taken out from the fluorescent or the optical channel. And this is extremely important whenever you have fragmented red cells and there is an overlap between them, and because of that, you are able to actually differentiate between the two. The moment you used fluorescence and you also used the optical channels for platelets, a very interesting parameter came up, and that is the immature platelet fraction. In fact, it's been one of the parameters which people have been talking about right, left and center. And as my friend and mentor, Dr. Sukesh, would always say, there is nothing immature about immature platelet fraction. And I would perhaps agree with it to a little extent. Just to emphasize the fact about the fact of use of immature platelet, the platelet fluorescent channel, what you can see here is that if you see this is a patient from the east part of the country wherein there was the platelet count was low on the impedance channel, about 134. But the moment you used the optical channel, the actual counts turned out to be 162,000. That was absolutely normal. And at that same time, I would also like to add something about immature platelet fraction, which was something which was talked about so vividly and nicely by my colleague and friend, Dr. Kunal, in one of his presentations where he called it immature platelet fraction, neighbor's envy and owner's pride. You know, just like the television which we used to use long time back from Onida, and there would be an advertisement where they would talk about it. And in fact, IPF became such a big rage that everybody wanted to have an instrument which has IPF onto it. Now, what is this IPF? The IPF is the immature platelet fraction. It is a fraction which is actually comprising of the large platelets, as you can see over here on the right-hand side, having higher fluorescence as well. So they're larger in size and they have higher fluorescence, and they are able to pick up, you know, the various counts of these platelets are able to actually give you a value with respect to certain disorders. So the important point about immature platelet fraction is it's been made to show that it's akin to something which is like that of a reticulocyte for the RBCs. So the low platelet counts and a high IPF actually tells you that the marrow is actually trying to produce, and it's a peripheral destruction of the platelets. Whereas if you have reduced IPF, and you know, at this, that means that the marrow is not producing enough. And in fact, we in our center have also worked on bone marrow transplants a lot and found that IPF happens to be one of the first indicators of bone marrow regeneration post-transplant. So the normal IPF range needs to be established in your specific analyzers. If you have the analyzer which has a measurability of looking at the immature platelet fraction, and it has to be processed within a specific period of time, that's within 6 hours of receiving the sample, otherwise you will not be able to get reliable parameter. In fact, a lot of the studies have been done with respect to IPF in various disciplines. One of the studies which I would say that was, you know, kind of, you know, if I may call it breath shaking, I would not be out of place, because it is first study of its kind at that point of time, which was done by my colleague, Dr. Tina, and her colleagues, Dr. Kunal and others, wherein they showed how immature platelet fraction was able to predict the use of, you know, the blood products in a particular individual, especially the platelets in dengue patients. So just to give you this picture, what you are seeing here is these are the pink and the blue lines. Follow them. The blue lines are the platelet counts in a dengue patient, which happened to fall over a period of time after he contracts dengue. And at the same time, as the platelets go down, the IPF keeps on going up. It gets stabilized at a certain point, at which point the platelets start coming up and the person becomes normal. So what they predicted in this study was that the moment you have a platelet count, you know, which is going down and it gets stabilized, at the same time IPF is going up and gets stabilized, the platelets are just around the corner and can help you not to transfuse the patient with the platelets. So IPF in dengue happened to be shown as a potential tool for predicting platelet recovery in dengue patients. And in fact, they had also tried to show that, you know, at the moment you have a single value of 10%, you will be able to have recovery within 24 to 48 hours, which eventually was proven wrong. But nevertheless, the study happened to be one of the very interesting and good studies, corroborated by many other investigators across the country later on. So this eventually said that, look, if you want to buy a hematology analyzer, you must have an IPF on it. Otherwise, why buy a hematology analyzer, you know, which is a five-part analyzer? Having said that, IPF in itself is not something which people need to really, you know, get worried about, because there are parameters like platelet to large cell ratio, which are equally good and give you information which is almost equal to what you get from the IPF. And a lot of us have done these studies and proven that PLCR expressed as a percentage of large platelets that have volumes beyond 12 femtoliters are the ones which are giving you information. And this is available from a lot of hematology analyzers, including the analyzers from Horiba, where we have shown that platelet to large cell ratio is able to give you equivalent information as what you predicted from the immature platelet fraction. So anytime when your platelet to large cell ratio is high, you know that the platelet large cells are very high and your platelet count is low. You know that the marrow is actually, you know, trying to produce more platelets, and when the PLCR is low, you know that the marrow is not functioning appropriately. So therefore, it becomes important for us to know that this is a kind of activity which one can do, and one can actually get hold of information to predict the thing with the way the IPF does for us. Now, coming to the interesting parameter, which is called the automated immunoplatelet counts, and the claim to it is that these are so-called true platelet counts. Why do we say so? Is because in this particular instrument, and one of the instruments, this is from Abbott, which you have, where we're using what is called a CD61 immunostain for the platelet counting. And because you're identifying platelets very specifically, it is able to give you the exact platelet counts. While this may be true to a large extent and may correlate very, very well with the platelet counts which come from a flow cytometer, the biggest challenge that you have with this is the cost. It happens to be a very expensive methodology of adopting it. What a normal platelet count would cost you maybe about 20, 30 or 50 rupees, this is eventually going to cost you at least 200 or 300 rupees for getting a platelet count done. Coming to automated platelet counts by flow cytometry. Now, flow cytometry, as I told you, happens to be the ICSH standardized methodology for assessing platelets. Of course, you can do platelet counting using dual platform, wherein you use a hematology analyzer and the flow cytometer, or a single platform. The important point, what has been used for platelet counting is a single platform methodology, wherein you're using the red cells versus the platelet methodology to get the counts. Coming to the last part of it, which is the smear-based platelet counting. I know there is a lot of challenge. All of us use smear-based platelet counts, and we need to be very clear about how many counts can be done. But there is a very interesting analyzer, which is from the company called Roche, and they had come up with an analyzer called Cobas M511, which would make what is called a monolayered blood film from an exact quantity of whole blood. A stain would be, you know, the slide would be stained, and eventually there would be a camera which would actually take pictures from the slide and eventually give you the exact counts. And this is how the whole concept was. The slide would have a monolayered film, and on that monolayered film, you would be actually able to count and give the exact platelet count. Perhaps this would be one analyzer which would be able to give you the count that you are most comfortable with, because you will be seeing something on the slide and then able to, you know, be comfortable in giving these counts. Unfortunately, this the production of this analyzer has been stopped completely, and this is not likely to come back onto the picture. So what are we left with? We are left with the usual platelet counting, what we have. What is there in future as far as the automated platelet counting is concerned? The future, we have what is called the in vivo counting of cells, which includes counting of platelets as well. You will have something like a transducer ultrasound, which will be tied across the wrist. We are already seeing a lot of these kind of things, which are based on certain apps in your phones. And this is something which is likely to happen in future as well. And we are not yet sure, will we be replaced so quickly or not? And it is perhaps only the time which will tell us whether the automated in vivo platelet counting is something that is going to be possible in due course or not. Now, when we come to automated platelet counts, the usual question which everybody keeps asking is, you know, you are telling us about so many different counts. You're saying impedance, you're saying optical, you're saying fluorescent, you're saying immunoplatelet counts, and you're then saying even the slide-based methodology, which is an analyzer-based or maybe made-based by you. What is the best methodology of platelet counting? Well, if we look at the best methodology of platelet counting, the comparisons between various methodologies have already been done by a lot of my colleagues as well as by us in our center, where we have noticed that when you have normal platelet counts, almost all analyzers give you similar counts, and it's you generally will not find a large difference between the counts given on normal platelet counts from two distinct analyzers. And the same has been proven across in lots of other studies as well. So having said that, does that mean that all analyzers are equally good or equally bad? The problem is that the moment we go to the lower platelet counts, the coefficient of variation or the variability between analyzers increases markedly. And the moment the coefficient of variation increases markedly, you're not able to give counts the way the count should ideally be given. And that's where the challenge comes in. So what is the best methodology for counting at low platelet count is anybody's guess. The ideal thing would be doing a flow cytometry-based platelet counting, but doing it on a regular basis is practically not possible. So what is the other way? The other way is look at the blood film and, you know, do a RBC and a platelet counting. And then depending upon the factor that you have created for your own laboratory, then basis that you are able to give a count. Now, when we have a counting, which we do for the platelets in our own laboratory, we must know and realize that every microscope has its own area of, a vision. So depending upon the area, your factor might be different. So what might be a factor for me as 10,000 in my lab might be a factor of 15 in another or 18 in the third one and maybe 20 in the other one. So this is where we have to be very cautious when we define our factors, and it needs to be defined in our own respective laboratories to know what we're dealing with. Now, automated platelet counting, when we look at across the analyzers, almost all the analyzers have similar issues, you know, compared to the reference method of RBC to platelet on a flow cytometer. They all have major issues with respect to counts which are at the lower levels or beyond their linearity limits. So remember, we need to be very mindful of this fact. And at the same time, assuring quality becomes important, where we need to ensure that we're putting we're putting controls for the platelets on a regular basis and ensuring that we get our right quality assurance in our counts. Remember, it's not important that, you know, if an analyzer keeps giving you an appropriate quality assurance, only that analyzer is good. All analyzers are potentially good unless you are not running the quality assurance in the right way. So if we look at a few cases now, a few cases which I would be able to talk about is just one of the cases. Like, this is a case of thrombocytosis. What you can see in this picture on the right upper quadrant is that you have a hump over here, which is giving you an indication that there is a larger platelets which are there in this particular case. And of course, they're also overlapping into the basophil channel. There is a very distinct separation between the red cells and the platelets. And this was a clear case of thrombocytosis in a patient who was having infection. Another case where there was a patient of acute lymphoblastic leukemia on treatment. Obviously, what's very obvious in the first picture up there, where you have these red blood cells, the red picture, you hardly have any platelets, very tiny and small platelets over there. And there was a clear case of thrombocytopenia. Another case wherein, you know, you had these platelet aggregates and they are overlapping, as you can see in the figure 2 up here. And there is still a clear distinction between the two, though there is an overlap into the lymphocyte area in this particular patient. And finally, the last case, we're looking at interference of the RBCs into the platelets. And what you're distinctly seeing, and as I had mentioned previously, you have this large aggregates of platelets, which is interfering, the RBCs, which is interfering into the platelet histogram and obviously not giving you the reliable platelets. So platelets will continue to be controversial. And therefore, one needs to be mindful of the fact that we need to know about all these methodologies of platelet counting and ensure that when we count platelets, we are giving the appropriate and the most appropriate counts for the patient. It is also important to realize that it's the man behind the machine who happens to be the most important person with respect to the analyzer science. And therefore, ensuring that the machine has optimally been calibrated and the machine has been optimally used and is giving us the reliable count the way we are expected to. And also setting up thresholds and flags is extremely important to ensure that we are giving the right information across to the patient for patient care. Thank you very much for your kind attention. I'll be happy to answer questions if there are any. I pass it back to Ankur.
Thank you, sir. Wow, wasn't it a captivating session? One of the most colorful and enlightening sessions. And I'm sure audience were as glued to the screen as I was. No wonder, sir, you are my favorite speaker too. Especially that correlation thing and case studies were very good.
Thank you.
So just let me come to the... So finally, now we can move to the question and answer session. And if there are any queries, please type in the chat box. So already we have few questions. Let me start with that. So one question is from Mr. Parag Thavkar. What would be the number of samples you need to compare for platelet count between cell counter and manual count on microscope to calculate the factor?
Okay, so thanks Parag for that question. It's a very interesting question. It's the reason why I would want every laboratory to make sure that they calculate their factor is what I already mentioned, because what may be a factor of 10,000 for me, somebody else might have calculated a factor of, you know, say 15,000, and another one a factor of 20,000. So imagine if I'm going to count 8 platelets in my field and the other guy is also counting 8 platelets in his field, and I'm multiplying it by 10,000, my count will be only 80,000, whereas the other guy counts it at 20,000, makes it 1,60,000. So therefore, an absolutely normal count versus a count which is thrombocytopenic. Now the question comes, how many samples should be looked at? So when we look at the number of samples which is statistically significant, the minimum number of samples is 20. Ideally, if you can go beyond 100 and more, that would make it more robust, because you're looking at counts, you know, which is so common. So when you look at any parameter which is extremely common, the higher the numbers, the better it is. But minimalistically, at least 20 samples should be looked at. Now, you do not choose, please do not choose low counts or extremely high counts for doing this activity, because they will never give you the right information. What is expected is that you take the counts, take the samples which are of normal counts. So anything which is between a normal platelet count and where there is absolutely no flagging by the analyzer, those are the counts which you need to look at on your smear as well, in the appropriately made smear, in an appropriately stained smear, and in the ideal zone. And then count the number of platelets in that, and accordingly create your factor for your assay. And this particular factor which you have defined and developed, you need to keep on revalidating it after every 6 months after the preventive maintenance of the machine. So this is what is expected, and at least a minimum of 20 samples, if not more.
Oh, thank you, sir. I think this also answers Dr. Savitri Singh's question and Silpi ma'am's question. Like, any guideline on manual platelet count? And second question, how do you derive factor for calculation? I think we have answered this, sir.
Yeah.
And now there is one more question from Mr. Alpesh. How to count platelets if they are clumps?
So there is nothing that can make you count the platelets if there are clumps. You cannot get exact counts for sure. But the moment there are counts, which are clumps in a smear when you're seeing platelets, you know for sure that the count which is coming from your analyzer is not reliable. What is important is that your analyzer optimization, the flag optimization, is appropriate. Because if your flags are not appropriate and your machine has not raised a flag of clump being in your analysis, there are times when you may not actually review the smear at all. So this is important to know. What I would suggest and recommend very, very strongly is, please make sure that your flag optimization, you get involved yourselves and ensure that the clumps have been, you know, platelet clump threshold has been put appropriately in your machine. Majority of the instruments have their teams, you know, who have developed these algorithms very well. But sometimes, depending upon the kind of sample collection that you have in your centers, you might need to, you know, maybe reduce the threshold or increase the threshold. This becomes extremely important in centers where they do not use evacuated tube system for collection of samples. But coming back to the question which you specifically asked, if you have clumps, giving an appropriate and exact platelet count based on that sample is practically not possible. All you can say is, if you're seeing good number of clumps in the smear, all you can say is that the count on smear appears adequate and you need to take a fresh sample appropriately mixed with DTA and or citrate, and then rerun the sample in the analyzer, hoping that this time you will not get clumps. Despite that, you may still get clumps in some of the cases, which happens. And in such cases, the best way to report, at least in my understanding and my opinion, is that put it on the report and say that, you know, the platelets are this many, are actually the count and the analyzer is superior because of the presence of clumps, and count on smear appears adequate. And that's where you can stop it and ask for a fresh sample.
Sir, thank you. But I would like to add something. So if like high end instrument is not giving any flag or something, if like count is very low or very high, so we can directly go without manual counting, right?
Yes, of course we can.
So now manual counting is becoming obsolete with high end instruments, like which uses high parameters like optical platelets and all.
Yeah, majority of the cases, yes, but there will still be a lot of cases where you will still require a manual review, and that's where the high-end analyzers become important. They should at least highlight it very clearly that, look, this smear you should be reviewing. For instance, if you have an EDT-induced pseudothrombocytopenia, and the machine, clump may not pick up clumps in some of the machines. Of course, most of the machines do pick up, but some of the machines may not pick up the clumps. And that's the time when you start getting problems, you know, in assessing the counts. What is extremely important in these cases would be that the machine is able to give you a flag and tell you, look, buddy, you need to review a smear and see. And that's where you will be able to pick it up. But I agree with you, Ankur, that majority of the new age hematology analyzers, especially the high-end ones, the need for reviewing the smear is going down with each passing day, and the usual slide review rate for majority of the good centers across the globe is anywhere less than 5 to 10%. In fact, a lot of other centers globally have reached a slide review rate of less than 5%. So that would be an ideal thing. Having said that, India is a bit different in that way, because all of us have similar practices of sample collection, and pre-analytics can give us a lot of trouble, especially with respect to the platelet count.
Oh, great. Dr. Prakash, I think your answer is also there, whatever said, and Dr. Namisha, same, like question was almost same. Now we are moving to another question, and this is from Dr. Gautam Gopal Bhagwat. Does IPF also help in determining role of platelet transfusion preoperative thrombocytopenia?
Well, it may not let you know whether you should go ahead with preoperatively transfuse a person with platelets. In fact, whenever you have a patient, you know, who has thrombocytopenia before the surgery, my first reaction would be, please find out why does he have thrombocytopenia at all. The reason of having, majority of the times, what I have noticed in our center, most of the times you get thrombocytopenia in patients who actually are going for an orthopedic surgery or some orthopedic kind of problems, who've taken aspirin or who've taken Brufen or who've taken some painkiller or the other, and it's generally a drug-induced thrombocytopenia. So coming back to the question, the moment you say, does IPF help you at all to know whether, you know, you should transfuse or not transfuse, for preoperative thing, I would strongly say, even if it does, you should not use it as a parameter for preoperative transfusions. IPF should only guide you to know whether your marrow is functioning or not functioning. So in this particular case, if IPF is high, you know that it's a peripheral platelet destruction. And if IPF is low, that it's a marrow which is not producing enough platelets. So that is the only guidance which it can give. But we should go to the bottom and find out why the patient is thrombocytopenic. You'll be surprised. There are patients which we picked up incidentally as leukemia when they came in for some surgery or, you know, some kind of a procedure, and they were incidentally found to be thrombocytopenic. So we need to at least find the cause and then take it from there.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for the wonderful answer. And now we have a question from Dr. Lavanya. Why do we obtain different platelet counts on various analyzers in thrombocytopenia? I think this depends upon the method, but still, sir, please.
So practically speaking, you have to understand, as I had mentioned in my presentation also, when you are doing platelet counting, if you are all using impedance methodology of platelet counting, again, depending upon how the thresholds are set, your counts will be variable. For instance, if you go to some analyzer, the threshold may be absolutely set threshold. And so therefore, you know, it will cut it off at a certain point and cut it off at a certain point for both lower and the upper limits of the platelet size. Then on the contrary, you may have another hematology analyzer where again it's impedance based, but the thresholds are mobile. They're not fixed at a certain point. So the moment they become a little bit mobile here and there, you might have slightly different platelet counts from one at the other. But having said that, in a normal platelet count, for a normal platelet count means any platelet count which is between 1.5 to 4.5 lakhs, and within the linearity limit of various analyzers, what you will observe is the variability between two analyzers will not cross more than 5 to 10%. And that's what is generally acceptable also. If you go to ICSH guidelines with respect to this, that's what is expected. It's only at the low counts that the variability starts going up, and that's normal for any parameter for that matter. It's not only with respect to platelets. Platelets more, yes, because they are we count them far more regularly. But even if you look at RBCs, even if you look at WBCs, the moment you have counts which are at lower limits, you will have a very high CV, and that's what is an expected thing with respect to statistics. So having said that, it's very important to realize that when we compare analyzers, please compare primarily at normal counts, between your normal counts. For all the counts, in normal counts is what is expected. Of course, the lower counts will also give you certain information which might be relevant.
Okay, thank you. Sir, there is some comment from Dr. Sukesh Nair, sir. International Journal of Laboratory Hematology, a nice review by Mario Plebani on reticulated platelet and IPF primary. He questions the terminology and recommend the word young platelets, and also recommends more specific RNA dyes are necessary to reduce the impact of the platelet size on the fluorescent signal defined.
Perfect. I agree with sir completely, and I have gone through the article, and I also strongly agree with the fact that, you know, rather than calling them immature platelets, I would rather call them young platelets. And as sir has presented previously so many times about IPF, it's very obvious that there is nothing immature about IPF, and that's what I said about this during my presentation as well. There's nothing immature about platelets, because immature platelet is what is a pro platelet, and this is something which Dr. Nair has so nicely and beautifully presented in his previous presentations. Yes, sir, I agree with you completely on that.
Yeah, thank you, sir, for your suggestion, and I also recommend all of you to go through this article. Thank you, sir. Then that question is from Dr. Prakash, who asks here, relevance of giving qualification of platelet count on the peripheral smear in case of thrombocytopenia. I think
qualification in what sense? Like, are we talking about, you know, whether there are giant platelets or no giant platelets? So if for that matter we're looking at it from that angle, it's nice to always talk about presence of large platelets or giant platelets and stuff like that. It's also important to talk about presence of clumps or no clumps. It's also important to talk about presence of fibrin clots or no fibrin clots, because sometimes all these parameters may actually signify, you know, the interferences which maybe we may actually be having in the platelet count. So therefore, it's important to qualify your statement wherever it's possible, but it may not be possible in all the cases. Also, presence of small platelets. You know, we keep talking about large platelets, because that's something which interferes in our counting most of the times. But we should also keep in mind that there is something called small platelets, and small platelets also at times can give us diagnostic clues, for example, in Viscott-Aldrich syndrome. So again, qualifying your statement with respect to platelet morphology also becomes important. It's also important to realize that platelets can have other abnormalities, like, for instance, their staining characteristics may be different, for example, in gray platelet syndrome, etc. So in all such conditions, qualifying your statement with respect to platelets in the peripheral blood film would become important and would actually give you very interesting and important diagnostic clues towards a particular clinical diagnosis.
Agreed, sir. Thank you. And now there's a question from Dr. Perez. Can we depend on MPV and or PDW as a surrogate for IPF in thrombocytopenia? Sir, I will also like to add something here. No. Can we go for PLCC, PLCR in place of IPF, since IPF comes at a cost?
Yeah, so if we look at it from with respect to PLCC and PLCR, the only challenges which we'll face at times is when we have fragmented red cells or RBC interference in the platelet channel. This happens in some of the cases. However, having said that, if we are very clear that the RBCs are pretty decent and we don't have any interference from the RBCs per se, PLCC and PLCR happen to be a very good parameter and may even work as a surrogate for your IPF. So I'm not saying that PLCC or PLCR will completely replace IPF and vice versa. Both have their important roles to play, but having said that, it's not that IPF makes something extremely, extremely great and the other thing extremely, extremely poor. So there is some information which you get from both. Again, mean platelet volume is a very good parameter. A lot of us, you know, would be using mean platelet volume. Even today, I use MPV as one of the measures. And mean platelet volume is also interesting and important, which helps us to differentiate various disease states in platelet disorders. So I agree with you, PLCC, PLCR and MPV would be able to give you information which may or may not be equivalent to IPF, but at the same time is not inferior to IPF per se.
So we can go with it, like if there are no disturbances and all.
Yes, of course.
Thank you. And so now there's a question from Mr. Salendra. Are all three-part differential cell counters impedance-based and five-part cell counters flow-based?
So more or less the answer to this question is yes, because impedance is the primary methodology of counting of red cell of the cells, and all three-part analyzers are primarily based on impedance-based counting. As far as the five-part differential analyzers are concerned, there is a variable, use of laser or no use of laser, or variable use of light scatter properties. But for all practical purposes, the five-part differential analyzers generally use an impedance along with an optical or a fluorescent or a flow cytometry based methodologies to differentiate between various cell types.
Okay, thank you, sir. And now there's a question from Mr. Manish. In case of manual slide review, how to calculate MPV?
So in a manual slide review, you can't calculate an MPV because you are not able to pick up the platelet size on the smear. So therefore, MPV is a parameter which is derived from a hematology analyzer, and that's the only thing you can depend upon. I can only add one more point to it, that sometimes when your counts are extremely low, some of the hematology analyzers, which are primarily fluorescence-based, where fluorescence-based counting is involved, you will note that the MPV as a parameter gets voted out. That's primarily because of the fact that the analyzer has been set in such a way that it's supposed to count certain number of cells to give you a reliable MPV, and it's not able to count that, it will not give you. So at such times, the MPV may not be even available. So generally, if you are still strongly wanting to get an MPV from a sample, then you would need to make a PRP and run that in the analyzer, and that will give you a mean platelet volume. But then the count from the PRP will not be reliable. So you have to trade off between the two, but you can still get an MPV. The important point, MPV from the smear cannot be made out. You can't make it out from the smear.
Of course, sir. So let me check if there are more questions. Yeah, one question is from Dr. Savitri Singh. How often we come across platelet satellitism?
Okay, so if I may, this will be more of an anecdotal data from my side. If I have been practicing for the last 18 years, maybe I would have seen a case, about 5 or 7 cases of satellitism. That's what I would have seen so far. So in other words, it's not that often that you see it. But yes, as far as the EDTA induced clumping is concerned, we have seen that more often, and of course the clumps due to pre-analytical reasons, that's again something which we have seen more often. Satellitism, in my experience, I have seen only about 5-7 cases in last almost 18 years. So I would suggest that it will probably be in terms of experience, it will be limited.
Yeah, I think this is such a topic, we can go on and on. But like we have to conclude this, sir.
Sure.
So now like we have come to the end of this webinar. So I would like to take this opportunity to thank dear audience for their time and constant support. And I was overwhelmed to see the number of audience. And Handu sir, thank you for that. It was because of you that we have like a huge audience over here.
Well, thank you very much. Pleasure
has been all. And for audience will be. Yeah, we'll be sending you a participation certificate too. And once again, thank you, audience. And thank you, Handu sir, for this brilliant session on platelets. And we will be coming again on 20th July, same time, 2 to 3 p.m. to place some light on erythrocytes. And we look forward to seeing you next time, and we'll put some extra effort into making our next program even more useful and thrilling. So stay tuned for the next session. Thank you once again. Stay home, stay safe. Namaste. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, and bye-bye.